Okay. Thank you very much, everyone. Can I ask Presidents Banga, Renaud Basso, Asakawa, Rousseff, and Goldfein to the stage? And of course, Mr. NK Singh, who's been running the expert group. Feel free to sit wherever you like. Thank you so much. Thanks for joining us. Thank you. Thank you very much. So bigger, better, bolder MDBs. That's the subject of this panel. And the session so far has talked about getting the finance flowing with collaboration, but I think Mahmoud was very clear-headed at the end as about some of the challenges we're still facing and the way we need to reimagine the system. So now we've got the opportunity to talk to MDB presidents and the World Bank president to talk quite specifically about the collaboration and how the system is rising to the challenge and coordinating, and how they're translating the increasing ambition we're seeing from countries and non-state actors in the transition. So as I said earlier, I do hope our panelists will keep to time. I will do my best to do that. But I'd be particularly interested in hearing about both financial and operating models, about country platforms and sectoral strategies, and also on debt solutions. What are the concrete things that we can do to move from ambition to action? And I'm going to start then with Ajay Banga. We spoke on day zero of your appointment, I think, along with many others, and thank you for doing the huge amount of listening that you did do early on the need for a better bank, as well as critically a bigger bank, and those two need to go hand in hand, and you talked so powerfully on that in Morocco. Can you tell us about the package of deliverables that you've brought to COP, and how you're using your role as potential coordinator, not just within the banks, but also private sector, civil society, and other actors?
Great, so Kate, thank you. And thank you for being so clear with your advice on day one. You helped me understand what I needed to get done in many ways. So thank you again for that. I think the first thing we've managed to do is to move our vision statement to move beyond poverty reduction and shared prosperity to include the idea of livable planet. I cannot emphasize to you how important that is. It changes the way our employees in the field and our staff and our shareholders feel about how our money and our effort and our knowledge should be put to work. It includes climate, it includes fragility, it includes pandemics, it includes food insecurity, things that are intertwined crises with poverty. So to me, that is really mission critical for the bank. Now, let me tell you how that translates into what's happening here. We've come here with five specific things. The first one you referred to, and I think the minister referred to it as well, 45% of our financing will go to climate by 2025. I'm really keen to keep it in a short frame. 25 is 2 years away. We will get to 45% by then. Of that, half will go to adaptation and half to mitigation, because we cannot make climate only be about emissions. It has to be about the downstream impact that the Global South is facing from those emission-heavy growth that we have enjoyed in other parts of the world. The second thing we've put together here is on methane, and the minister and I were discussing it. He specifically asked me to mention it. What we're saying is that we will, over the next 18 months, with 15 countries, sign up to attack the methane that is emitted from rice paddy cultivation, from livestock, and from waste management. We've got very specific projects in the field. We can quantify what the savings in methane are. We're going to get this done. In the next 5 to 7 years, we pull 10 million tons of methane out of the system. Methane is 80 times more dangerous than carbon dioxide. Methane gets 2% of climate finance. We need to start talking about methane and doing something about it. That's the second big thing. Third big thing, everyone told me in London when we were having lunch with you, various of the civil society folks there, that Africa has 600 million people without power. We're announcing a $5 billion from IDA and $10 billion from private sector to hit 100 million people with power in Africa, solar energy and grids developed and done. 7 years from today, it'll be finished. Funded and finished. Fourth, I am not finished. Four, I've got five things to tell you. Fourth item, voluntary carbon markets. I believe that the only way to get money from the developed world to the developing world in a constructive way is to do something about voluntary carbon markets. The bank has been working on forestry-related credits for a while. We have now got five countries ready to go, 11 more in the pipeline. By the end of next year, all 15, 16 should be in. We think we can generate 24 million credits next year, 125 by the end of 5 years. If I can get $20 for each of those credits, not for five and not 100, but 20, that's real money. Why do I think I can get 20? These are projects we are involved with. We are doing jurisdictional audits on the quality of the credit so we can give it an environmental integrity tick box. We're also doing, most importantly, social integrity audits to make sure the money goes to the community and the indigenous people living there. Actually, Ilan is very helpful on this with the work we're doing together in the Amazon. And so that is the fourth item. The fifth item is the idea of those climate-resistant debt clauses. Not only are we pausing debt repayment, we are pausing interest for 2 years, and most importantly, the cost of doing all this liquidity and fees we are absorbing through our own trust funds. And the idea of doing that is to give everybody a free option with no tags attached on having to cater to a catastrophe that no one is designed for. A small state that loses double digits of its GDP cannot cope with debt repayment at that time. So those are the kinds of things we're working on. A lot of this is working through collaboration, and I'll finish there. Ilan is on the stage, so he knows this. Others are here too. A lot of this is addressed in NK's report. He'll talk about it. But the idea of collaborating as a system is mission critical. If we cannot get our standards, which is what the EBRD and us are doing, or if we cannot get collaboration on projects or co-financing done in a very simple way, then we are not being the best partners for our clients in the field. That is something we're all committed to working on together.
Thank you so much. And just because it hasn't been mentioned so far, I just wanted to highlight your mention of methane and non-CO2 gases. If we're keeping the most vulnerable communities at the front of our minds, this is the best way to slow temperature increase, because it's like a break, because the emissions don't last so long in the atmosphere. So thank you for really centering that, as well as all the other work you outlined. Thank you. President Asakawa, ADB has played a key role in the Indonesia JETP and has been a leader in innovation also through its ETM initiative. And we've heard about hybrid capital and guarantees, and you've been a real pioneer there. And the Bangladesh government has just announced a country platform where you're the leading partner. And we heard from Mahmoud in the previous panel just how exciting some of that is. So please do go ahead and tell us a bit more about these innovations and how to scale them.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Kate, for raising those three initiatives we have been working on. First of all, country platform, especially on Bangladesh. Like our fellow MDBs, ADB is answering the call to scale up climate action. Thank you. We also recognize that no single institution's development partner can do this alone. So we have been working to develop the Bangladesh Climate Development Partnership, BCDP, with the government of Bangladesh and development partners. Led by government, it will bring together stakeholders across sectors. It will focus on finance, policy reforms, project preparation, knowledge, and monitoring. This platform will align with Bangladesh's vision to become a developed country by 2041. Under the partnership, development partners will align their country programs with Bangladesh's climate priorities. And this partnership will help to secure long-term commitment and predictability in climate financing. It will also contribute to the development of the country's climate finance architecture and help mobilize private sector financing. Second item I'd like to touch on is ETM. I am very proud of our ETM, Energy Transition Mechanism. which has the potential to be the one of the biggest carbon reduction programs in the world. ETM was developed in partnership with our developing member countries to leverage a market-based approach to accelerate the transition from fossil fuels to clean energy. The ADB ETM program is currently engaging with 5 countries, Indonesia, Kazakhstan, Pakistan, Philippines, and Vietnam. It is also considering transactions in others. ETM has the potential to help countries reach more ambitious emissions targets than their current one. Two, reduce energy costs by speeding up the retirement of coal, oil, and diesel of fired electricity, which will increase the demand for clean energy and lower overall energy generation costs. And three, drive investment in renewable energy by unlocking investments in efficient and cost-effective renewable energy, such as hydrogen, electric vehicles, and other clean technologies. And finally, on IFCAP, ADB is working with partners to scale up climate investment, including from private sector. The IFCAP, which stands for Innovative Financing for Climate in Asia and the Pacific, will use guarantee mechanism of ADB's sovereign loan portfolio to leverage billions of dollars for climate investment. IFCAP is the very first leveraged guarantee mechanism for climate finance to be adopted by MDBs. IFCAP will strengthen ADB's development member countries' capacity to develop their low-carbon and climate-resilient strategies and build a larger pipeline of potential investment. IFCAP was approved by ADB's board in April this year and was officially announced in May at ADB's 2023 annual meeting. Japan's $600 million contribution, just announced here in Dubai a few days ago, has increased IFCAP's financing guarantee to over $1 billion, which also includes $300 million contribution from the United Kingdom and $100 million from the Republic of Korea. With a model of $1 in, $5 out, our ambition is to secure $3 billion in guarantee, which could create up to $15 billion in new loans by much needed climate prospects. Projects across Asia and the Pacific.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And it's great to hear the high leverage that you're getting from some of that early work. I'm now going to turn to President Honobaso. EBRD has done some really interesting work in both Egypt and I heard the other day also in North Macedonia that's very pertinent to our conversation. But you've also made some large-scale institutional commitments as well, right? So please tell us about those.
Yes, so a few years ago, we made the commitment to be 50%, to have 50% of our financing in the green sector. We reached that in advance already last year, and we will keep on track on this commitment. And since this beginning of this year, 2023, we are fully Paris aligned, which means that we look at every project and need to ensure that it's consistent with the objective of 1.5. Looking at that, and you know, we have a business model which is focused mainly on private sector, 75% of our activity in the private sector, 25% in the public sector, a lot of sub-sovereign, and this was discussed previously, but I think this is a very important dimension. We realize that in order to really address climate change, and we need, of course, to work project by project, to bring our competence, to work with our clients in delivering the project, but that a more holistic approach was needed. Because it's very, I mean, we all know it's quite challenging to deliver a green transition for the energy sector or for the industrial sectors. It's a complex issue, touching upon a number of actors in the country and so forth. And that's on the demand side. On the offer side, I mean, the financing side, it's also very complex. You have all the MDBs working together, but with their different mandate. You want to bring the private sector, you want to bring the concessional financing, or you need to bring some concessional financing. And that's where we realized, I think, that really working on country platform, on a holistic strategy is very efficient. So we designed that with Egypt last year in the COP with what it's called NWEFI initiative, where we are in charge of the energy pillar, and the commitment was to decommission inefficient gas power plant for 1.5 gigawatt, deliver 10 gigawatt of renewable, and have the accompanying measure in order to ensure that this can function for the country. And this has worked very well. We managed to unlock 500 million of concessional financing in order to be able to finance, you know, the grid, the just transition dimension, reskilling people, helping with the preparation of the project. And this will trigger 10 billion of investment, US dollar investment in the renewable. And implementation is already going on, so it's a sort of JETP, but already being implemented, and decommissioning will start first quarter 2024. The grid financing is on track, and we already start with IFC financing of some of the renewable. The other example we have is North Macedonia, where the country commits to close every coal power plant by 2030, and coal represents today 40% of the energy mix of the country, and to move towards renewable. We will get some financing from a climate fund in order to help there also with the just transition and to finance the grid there also, and we'll finance renewable with a private sector. I think this approach is what we need to do. We are looking also at some thematic approach like industry decarbonization in some countries, so how to define the pathway in very heavily industrialized country like Turkey, and how do you work with the government, with the private sector, and the manufacturing business in particular, to go for decarbonization. So I believe that these are very important tools in order to deliver on the ground and to match between the concrete work on the ground and the big objectives we have.
Thank you very much, Odile. And I really want to highlight something that's also really crucial for this COP, which is renewables are increasingly dealing with increasing energy demand. And if the IEA is right, and we're at peak fossil carbon or close to it, our real job now is to focus on the trajectory down of fossil carbon, but also non-CO2 gases, and really think about how we're going to get to the near halving of emissions by 2030 that is necessary. And it's really great to hear practical examples of how you are financing that transition, because greenfield sites are one thing, but actually really dealing with some of the brown transition and moving to green is much more complex, and something also that the private markets need to get a grip on. So thank you for your leadership on that. NK Singh, we were on a panel earlier, and I unfortunately had to cut you off because we were running out of time. And I just want to point out it wasn't his fault, it was people before him. You've put out two really important reports this year, and you're the critical friend on our panel today. Please tell us where you think there's been progress, and we're going to give the MDB presidents a good end of year holiday, but what do you want them doing on January 2nd?
Well, thank you very much. First of all, I'm really grateful for this opportunity to be able to be part of this very distinguished panel, and with your very calibrated moderation, if I may say, a difficult task. So let me say, we have come a long way in a short time. And let's at least take credit for the number of achievements. What are these achievements? First and foremost, go back a year ago. The nature of the dialogue and conversation has changed fundamentally. We know what to do. We have a program. We have quantifiable targets. These programs have been broadly endorsed by the international community. Endorsed very, very triumphantly in Marrakesh, which you all know. Thereafter, note three events which took place. The Paris Pact, the OECD declaration made a lot of progress beyond Marrakesh. Thereafter, in the session which you had earlier, the contents of the Nick Songwe Amas Bhattacharya is very far-reaching. Great symmetry between the recommendations which we made and now. Look at the declaration which was adopted day for yesterday, which really more or less is in the same area. So we are really having a convergence of belief. Is it only belief? No. I think that credible action has begun. Well, all multilateral development banks, in some measure or the other, towards what objective? Towards the objective which the minister and others have mentioned of having a better bank. What do I mean by better? A better bank which is has institutional mechanisms, has a country platform, has a robust pipeline of projects to be financed, and which is really more and more responsive to client needs. Better. We also know that we need to have bolder banks. Bolder means that instead of risk aversion, more informed risk decision making. I think that some of the banks have shown great path on it. Must compliment the number of initiatives that in his short period the president of the World Bank has undertaken in multiple directions. And in terms of the alacrity with which, based on what the G20 did, to set up 30 working groups on each of these 30 recommendations, that's not a small achievement. That's now part of the whole process in which we can monitor. And bigger banks, bigger in terms of not only adequately harnessing and optimizing the balance sheet, on that, of course, I must compliment really the Ajay that the World Bank has begun, I mean, credible processes, getting approvals of executive boards, getting its own governance structure and so on into it. I think the other MDBs in some ways should follow and replicate that. Is that the end of the story? No, because you need bigger bank will ultimately need additional finances to be put in. And we cannot overlook the need for additional finances by just really saying, get the balance sheet optimized and take bolder decisions. What are the key areas of expectations, in my view? In four lines, the key areas of expectations. Have we done enough, or is it adequate to be able to harness private capital? A daunting challenge on that. A very credible report was given by B20, under the Indian presidency, which some members, Ajay is aware of, they are also in the private sector lab which he has set up. And I think we need to take some note of that, of how to mitigate risk, foreign exchange risks, how to mitigate risks in being able to better regulatory standards, how to really improve the entire framework, a regulatory framework. That's one big area, the private sector capital harnessing. The second big area is, have MDBs begun to work as a family where the sum becomes, the ultimate thing is bigger than the sum of the parts. And that requires thinking. I'm very aware of what the next speaker, she had very repeatedly, very legitimately pointed, that each one has their own shareholders. They all have their own accountability patterns. They are in different ways accountable to their own ethos in which they work, but within the framework of that, while respecting all that, working as a family will make a decisive change. The last point, and I'll stop there. We need to keep our focus strongly on this subject. There are multiple initiatives, including the one being undertaken by COP on this important issue, to remain focused, to monitor progress on appropriate occasions, like, for instance, this today's meeting, like what is going to happen in spring meeting, in the midterm review of the COP, in terms of the annual meeting. And I must really say that updating the kind of reports that the World Bank has done, following on the spring meeting, they followed it up by another report which focused on climate in Marrakesh. I'm sure that by the time of the spring meeting and annual meeting, there'll be further updates, not only from the World Bank, but from all other multilateral development banks. Let me end on an optimistic note, that we should take some pride in the achievements of the last 1 year, the multiplicity of action, the consciousness which we have, and the urgency which we realize we need to take to be able to meet the challenges which lie ahead of us. Thank you very much for this opportunity.
Thank you. Well, that's an extraordinarily clear scorecard. Thank you very much. And you've made my job summing up a lot easier. So thank you very much for that. We're now going to turn to President Rousseff, who runs MDB, established by the BRICS in 2014. Could you please share with us your views on the crucial issue of local currency financing and how you can contribute to deepening local capital markets, particularly in emerging markets and developing countries? Thank you.
Many international studies show that in virtually all recent financial crises in emerging markets and developed countries, currency devaluation combined with volatility interest rates have been playing a crucial and definitive role. This occurrence produced a mismatch between debts in dollar or in other strong currencies, and the receipts in local currency. The consequence is recurrent and profound debt crises that compromise the capacity of investment and climate action, SDG, and nationally determined contribution. Largest output falls, loss of jobs, and crescent unemployment social setbacks have occurred in Latin America, in Africa countries, and even in Asia. The momentum to spend local currency has a concrete basis. According to the World Economic Forum agenda, by 2026, emerging economies will account for 45% of world trade growth. Although international trade in general did not experience exceptional growth in the last decade, only 30.7 per annum, some developed countries like China have dramatically increased their share of global value chain trade in the period, also in all the Asia area. There also has been a substantial and sustainable surge in transactions in emerging market currencies over the last 20 years. So there is a basis. Another thing that is important is to understand that the use of local currency should be understood not against, but as a complementary and diversified initiative inside the international financial system based on the centric currencies like United States dollar and euro. The local currency is one of the components of a more multilateral order. Therefore, it's clear the importance of hedge fund and local currency. But what are the means to do this? First, the steady tendency, as we have seen, towards growing bilateral trade between emerging markets that gives rise to increased returns on the scale in the use of their respective currencies, to the detriment of those obtained with the other currencies, strong currencies. Second, the emission in local currency, besides happening in local capital market, will have a main effect to strengthen the local capital market. Third, mechanisms as the Contingent Reserve Agreement, CRA, like the other proposed by the BRICS country, constitute insurance schemes to counterbalance the balance of payment crisis. It should be noted that in order to fulfill our commitment to finance the private sector in Global South, in our member countries, funding local currency is essential as it provides borrower with greater security. The flow of payments to the banks is denominated in the same currency as the flow of receipts generated by the projects, thus imparting stability to the project finance schemes and public-private partnerships, among other financial models, and don't incur in huge costs of hedging. The MDB is committed to the fight against climate change and provide investment in climate change in all our investments, projects, infrastructure, and social aspect, fighting against inequality, but because we understand that development is only possible is if it is sustainable, inclusive, and resilient. So we think is fundamental to make any agreement in the cooperation between MDBs to provide more local raising funds in local currencies. And we need for to build bigger, bolder, and better, and more effective MDBs to think that there is some conditions that if you don't, if we don't address, we cannot finance, because we don't control the macroeconomic conditions. We don't control the movement to raise interest rates and also to make a consequence in the other currencies in the world.
Yeah.
For that, the local currencies is a kind of securitization of the movement to invest. So combine local currency with strong currencies is a condition to invest in climate change, because I think there is a problem. We won't face the problems of climate change if we not change the finance condition architecture to the global south.
Thank you very much. Thank you. And it is indeed something that is of huge concern to many countries that I've been speaking to, that it's not necessarily the quantum of debt, but the structure of debt that makes them particularly vulnerable to external shocks. So we must tackle this issue of currency, scaling up some of the interventions around managing currency risk, but also, as you say, deepening local capital markets and local currency support. I'm now going to move to President Goldfein. We're slightly over time, so just so that the organizers know, I will try and wrap up within the next 5 minutes. You're going to be head of the MDB group, and it's nice to finish with some strong representation from Brazil as well, because we have the Brazilian G20 and COP30, so really exciting to hear about that agenda. Could you briefly say what you're going to do going forward? But also, there's some exciting news from IDB. I don't want to take that away from you, so thank you.
So thank you, Kate. It's a pleasure to be here. I see 0 minutes, that I cannot do, but more than maybe one, two, I can do. Well, the exciting news is that we are gonna triple our financing to climate and nature to 150 billion out of 50 billion today, or next 10 years. That actually is something that we're very proud of. We are also concentrating on some particular places, the Amazon Forever program, where we're going to have 5 billion additional financing. We are bringing several areas, we're bringing the development banks that they're going to finance up to 20 billion. We are talking to the private sector, to the private banks. We are coordinated with the World Bank on the Amazon bonds, and I'm not going to high-five here.
Oh, can't we have another high-five?
Yeah, but we can do it, okay.
Excellent.
We are partnering with other, with governments where, for example, Sweden gave us guarantees exactly for the Amazon. Italy and Spain just came up. So that's a way that you start with a program, it's holistic, you bring everybody together, that gives momentum. MDBs, it's a very interesting coincidence. The G20 is coming to the region. We're gonna have the G30 in Belém, Pará. We are the IDB in the rotating. We are gonna have the presidency. I think the combination is that we are getting agendas aligned, and I think we can work together. And thinking about working together, that's the first item which is very important. How can we work as a system? And work as a system cannot be just an abstract concept, it's in practice. It means country platforms. And country platform, what do they mean exactly? It's co-financing, it's projects, it's coming together like Bangladesh. Is about standards, is about harmonization of goals. What is it exactly? And that's what we're gonna talk about because it's about all of that. It's also about resources, scale, CAF recommendations. We talk about here about the SDRs. The previous high five was about SDRs. Yeah. How can we do it? Can we do it together? There was a session here just recently. That's important. Other part is not only about balance sheet, but it's about innovative instrument. We're talking about here CRDCs. This is important. We are all aligned on that. We're talking about domestic currency, IMF, World Bank. We just heard Dilma Rousseff talk about it. We are thinking about a pilot program with Brazil on currency hedging. We can do together has an agenda. Yeah. And we are recently launched a workforce with the DFC on helping countries find solutions like debt swaps that we had with Ecuador, Barbados, on sustainability linked bonds. We have our BID Clima, which gives lower cost of debt if you reach some targets. So given the amount of time I have, let me just close saying, we have quite an ambitious agenda, but I see that we are all with the same energy and really willing to work together on MDB as a system, on innovating instruments, on capital recommendation, and entering into the countries, into the regions together. So that's, I think, a very good sign, at least from my perspective, of the next 12 months in terms of our MDB agenda.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And I just want to bring this panel to a close by thanking the presidents of the MDBs and NK Singh for their very insightful remarks. I'm going to cut my comments short, but I just want to echo something that NK Singh said about the convergence of belief that we've seen here. The declaration of leaders on a global climate financial framework is so important because obviously all of the people on the stage here have shareholders. What we need is activist shareholders that are going on the journey that we're talking about. That means finance ministers and heads of state need to